بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وقرآنه الحميد وقوله الحق: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنما وليكم الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم راكعون. ومن يتول الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا فإن حزب الله هم الغالبون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Last night we began our discussion, inshallah, over the next those three nights. First of all, by talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create us? The reason for the creation. And we mentioned four reasons for the creation. Three of them stem from the Holy Quran, and one comes from Al-Imam Al-Husayn salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. And we used an acronym for the reason of the creation. Do you remember that? What was it? Warm. Very good, mashallah. The W in warm referred to what? Worship. Worship. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The A referred to what? Acquiring knowledge. The R, which refers to the hadith of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, refers to, what is it? Recognition. Ahsantum. And finally, the M was an ayah again from the Quran, the third ayah, which refers to mercy. Three of them come from the Quran, except the recognition, the ma'rifah, which is from the hadith of Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi. We gave these verses and we gave those backgrounds to the individual, so the references are all there. Then we said that one of the reasons for the creation is that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, how do we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah has given us guidelines that Allah has these holy names, Asma'ul Husna. And then Allah says, call him, fad'uhu biha. Then call him through these names. And we mentioned another ayah in Surah Ghafir, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala equates the dua, fad'uh, dua, equates it with ibadah, worship. And therefore, the dua here, fad'uhu biha, means worship Allah through these holy names. Well, what are these holy names? We refer to hadith of Imam al-Sadiq, salamullahi alayhi, where he says, nahnu asma'ullah al-husna. We are the holy names of Allah. And what this means is that we are the ones who guide people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through us, you can be guided to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no other way. We know there is only one way. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Ihdina as-sirat al-sirat. Means the path. Guide us to the path. Not to a path. No, the straight path. There is one. The. Even in English language, when you put the definitive article, the, it means you're referring to something specific. If I say the house, it means I'm referring to a specific house. Okay. The car, to a specific car. Not a. Here, the word the definitive article is used. As-sirata. It guide us to the straight. So there is one specific straight path. What is that straight path? صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. Here's the, that's the straight path. The path of those whom you have sent your ni'mah, your blessings, your guidance upon them. الحاكم الحنفي الحسكاني. A man who's Hanafi in his madhab has written a book called شواهد التنزيل. In that book, شواهد التنزيل, he says, I attended once a majlis. In the introduction of the book, no, this was a few hundred years ago, he says, I attended a majlis once where the speaker says there is not a single ayah in the Quran revealed about Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Now this man is a Hanafi, he's not a follower of the Imam. However, he says that upset me, that statement. You know, how could this person say there is not a single ayah? I mean, this man was, you know, was has some sense of justice in him. He did not have any bias in him, this Hakim al-Hasakan. He said, so I decided to compile a whole book on the verses that were revealed about Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam in the Quran. He's Hanafi, he's not a Shia, not a follower of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. He wrote this book called Shawahid al-Tanzil. The first ayah he uses is this one, Ihdina al-Sirat al-Mustaqim. So the first thing he starts with, Ihdina al-Sirat al-Mustaqim, he narrates a hadith from Ibn Abbas where he says, As-Sirat al-Mustaqim, As-Sirat Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. Allahu salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So that is the Sirat al-Mustaqim. This is the straight path. There is no other paths. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam are the leaders of this path, the guides to this path. This path, when I look at Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, who are the pillars of this universe, the pillars of guidance, then I need to follow them so that I can reach to safety. And hence we went with the hadith or the dua of Zamanul Ghaybah, where we said that in this dua, we pray to Allah, Ya Allah, make me recognize you, for if I don't recognize you, I won't recognize your messenger. Oh Allah, make me recognize your messenger, for if I don't recognize your messenger, I won't recognize your hujjah, your proof. Oh Allah, make me recognize your hujjah, for if I don't recognize your hujjah, your proof, then I would be misguided from my religion. ظَلَلْتُ عَنْ دِينِي. And we read in Surah Al-Fatiha, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا وَتْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. I don't want to be among the misguided. But if I don't recognize the hujjah, I will be among the misguided. ضَلَلْتُ عَنْ دِينِي. And I don't want to take chances. I don't want to be misguided from my religion. So I will follow those people. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَدُعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah has these virtuous names, holy names, that you need to seek Him, worship Him through them. And those are Ahlul Bayt, Salamullahi alayhim. They are the guides to Allah. Not only are they the guides to Allah, they are the essence of this entire creation. Because we read in Dua Kumail, وَأَسْمَى وَبِأَسْمَائِكَ الَّتِي مَلَأَتْ أَرْكَانَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And with your holy names, I ask you, Ya Allah, that have filled the corner, arkan, of everything, everything, arkan. مَلَأَتْ أَرْكَانَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, everything. And we read the Prophet is رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He's a mercy to this entire universe. The whole universes, in fact, not just the universe of dunya, but even the universe of the heavens. Even there, he's rahmah, he's a mercy. So Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam are at the corners of this entire universe, or universes. And this explains the hadith we read in Hadith al-Kisa. إِنِّي مَا خَلَقْتُ سَمَاءً مَبْنِيَّةً وَلَا أَرْضًا مَدْحِيَّةً وَلَا قَمَرًا مُنِيرًا, and so on and so forth. In other words, I did not create all these creations except for the love, إِلَّا فِي مَحَبَّةِ هَؤُلَاءِ الْخَمْسَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ تَحْتَ الْكِسَاءِ, except for those, for the love of those five. When Jibreel asks, who are those five? Allah answers, فَاطِمَ وَأَبُوهَا وَبَعْلُهَا وَبَنُوهَا. So this whole universe was created because of them. The universe created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason for the creation, the cause, is Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. All right. That's the conclusion we come up with. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order for us to recognize Him, His greatness, to remember Him, we need to follow the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. As Rasulullah is referred in the Quran in Surah Al-Talaq, the ayah referred to last night, as dhikr, dhikran, rasulah. And Allah tells us, fas'alu ahla dhikr, ask the people of the dhikr. When you don't know, Therefore, if we live the life of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, follow their example, then we are in constant dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that may be what is referred to in Dua Kumail towards the end, where Allah says, Ya man ismuhu dawa wa dhikruhu shifa. The one whose name is the medicine, and these are Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. But unless you live their lives, you follow their examples, you actually become one of their sincere Shia like Salman, Abu Dhar, Ammar, and so on and so forth, then when you do so, then you become dhikruhu shifa. Then their life, their examples become a cure for you. And that's what Allah refers to in the ayah, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. On the contrary, if you choose not to follow them, Allah says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي in Surah Taha, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. Anyone who decides not to follow, to reject my dhikr, dhikri. We said the dhikr according to the Quran, who was it? Huh? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He is dhikr. Anyone who rejects the dhikr and the family of the dhikr, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ, then he will have a tight living. Tight means he suffocates. He will never be happy. He cannot find happiness. No joy in dunya and in akhirah. So the only way to achieve that peace, tranquility, to have that cure, is through the following of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. All right. Now we come to these great personalities. The ayah we just read this evening, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Innama waliyukum Allah wa rasuluhu walladhina amanu. The ayah says, indeed, your masters, waliyukum, wilaya, are only, innama adatu hasrin. Hasr means, it means only these people. That's it. Wherever the Quran or the, ask any person who knows anything about Arabic language, he'll tell you, innama means only, adatu hasr, means you're only talking about these people. Okay, Allah says, innama waliyukum Allah. Your masters are only Allah. Okay, so Allah is a master. What does it mean that Allah is a master? And who else? Allah by himself? No. Wa rasuluhu. Messenger is also a master. Okay. What does it mean that Allah is your master, the messenger? Does it mean that Allah is your friend? No. What nonsense? Which aqil would say that wilaya here means Allah is our friend? No. Allah is my friend. No. That's what wilaya means. Of course not. Master, waliyukum Allah. Allah has the wilaya over you. He has the right over you. Mastery. Okay. In other words, anything he dictates, you have to do. Ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul. Obey Allah and obey the messenger. Halas. Allah dictates. We have to follow. Allah has a mastery over this entire universe. Okay, great. Then, only Allah and his messenger? No. Walladhina amanu. And those believers, those who yuqimuna salat, establish the salat. And يُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. They give zakat while they are in the state of ruku'. Okay, great. Now we need to go to something that's known as Asbabul Nuzul. Why was this ayah revealed? Why was it revealed? So that we can understand, can have some understanding. A poor man comes to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And the Muslims were praying behind Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi in the salat. This poor man, this beggar, says, Muslims, help me. I am in need. Please give me something. The Muslims are in the state of salat. No one pays attention to him. So this poor man, he turns to Allah. He says, Allahumma ashhad. Oh Allah, bear witness on those people. I am in your masjid asking for help and no one is helping me. So while they were in the state of ruku', Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam Ali salamullahi alayhi, extend his arm forwards, and he had a ring on his pinky finger, on his index finger. Oh, sorry, not the index, the pinky one, the smallest finger. He had a ring, and he signaled to this poor man to come and pick up the ring. So this poor man understood the signal, came and took the ring from the hand of the Imam, salamullah alayhi, while he was still in the state of ruku'. Okay? The Muslims then finished their salat. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, after the salat, raises his hands, and he says, Allahumma. Oh Allah, when Musa alayhi salam was sent as a messenger, he asked you that you provide him with a brother, with a helper, a supporter. and that is Harun. And you answered him and said, سَنَشُدُّ عَضُدَكَ بِأَخِيكَ, we will strengthen you with your brother. And here I am, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Allahum salli ala Muhammad. نَبِيُّكَ وَصَفِيُّكَ, I am your prophet and the chosen one whom you chosen. Asking you, Ya Allah, to make Ali ibn Abi Talib as my supporter and my brother and my helper, and you strengthen me with him or through him. And this ayah was revealed to Rasulullah, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. اللهم صل على محمد. If anyone is interested in the references for this, refer to one of our mufassirin, Sheikh Nasir Makarim Shirazi, in his tafsir al-Amthal. Refer there. He lists all the references from all Muslims. Look at the references. He lists several of them, over 10. So there is really no dispute about this issue here. And in fact, one of them, one of those mufassirin, Az-Zamakhshari. Az-Zamakhshari, interestingly, in his tafsir, he argues against those who argue that this verse was not revealed about Imam Ali salamu alayhi. He argues against them. He says, on what basis do they claim that it was not revealed? What? Because then Allah says, Alladhina amanu, it was not, you know, one person, Alladhi, because he was. He says, all these arguments are, you know, fallacies. They're not valid. There are many examples in the Quran where Allah uses a plural about one individual thing. So, and so on and so forth. So he goes on through all their arguments, interestingly, where he proves it at the end that this ayah was revealed about Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. So here we go, okay, so that's great. So this ayah, ayah of wilaya. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wilaya. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has wilaya. Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi has this wilaya, this mastery, this masterhood. What does that wilaya entail? This wilaya can be divided into two branches, two categories. We have a wilaya which is known as al-wilaya tut-takwiniyah. And we have a wilaya which is known as wilaya tut-tashri'iyah. What do we mean by this? Wilaya takwiniyah means the control over the creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created this universe, he set some certain laws. Certain things are set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sun, for example, rises from where? You guys awake? Are you with me? Where does the sun rise from? Or should we? Huh? Alhamdulillah, good. It rises from the east, sets in where? The west. Good, mashallah, good. Alhamdulillah. Because I remember last time when I asked you about some math question, I remember you guys didn't answer that math question. This was about a month ago when I was here, so it got me worried. Now, alhamdulillah, I'm a bit satisfied. Can any human being get up and say to the sun, you know what, I would like you today to rise from the west, not from the east? No, we don't have that power. Nor does the sun have a power itself. The sun cannot say to Allah, Ya Allah, I want a vacation. Every day I get up, you know, and rise, set, right? Khalas, give me a vacation for a month. No, doesn't have that. That's does not have that ability. Allah set it, it's set. Khalas, no one has an ability, except for a few individuals who I come to. But Allah, that's a matter of creation. The food that you eat, you have a control over putting it in your mouth and swallowing it. That's in your control. Once you swallow it, can you tell your stomach, stop, you know, I don't want you to digest this food? No, khalas, it's out of your control now. Unless, of course, you put interventions, medications and things, but naturally you cannot do anything, khalas. The process will take its course. And the food will be absorbed. That you have no control. Why? Because it's a matter of creation. That's how Allah created things. Certain laws. Musa alayhi salam became ill one day. He turned to Allah, he said, Ya Rab, my Lord, are you not the one who created these viruses that made me, you know, we call them viruses, bacteria, now that we know. These whatever germs that made me sick, aren't you the creator? He said, yes, I'm the creator. I created these germs. He said, are you not capable of curing me? Yes, I am capable of curing you. He said, then Ya Allah, cure me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered him. He said, Musa, it's true. I am the creator of these germs that made you sick. And I am capable of curing you. However, I also made laws in this universe. I made laws. And you, being a prophet of Allah, I want you to be a role model of using these laws. We get headache. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for us a cure for the headache. Scientists discovered it, and now they formulated it in the form of a pill that you might swallow to relieve you from your headache. Allah says, I want you to use these means. That is through my creation. There are laws in this universe. You got to follow these laws. So Allah created certain things. I am cold. You know, And that's metaphoric. Right now I'm you know, burning from heat, mashallah. I feel like fried chicken here, you know, up on the minbar. But if I'm feeling cold, and say, Ya Allah, provide me with heat. Ya Allah, give me heat. You know, what, will the heat come? You know, the fire will come from heaven? No. Allah says, you know, I created clothes. There is fire. There are heaters, etc., etc. Use these means, and that will give you heat. That's Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has created for us. These are matter of creations. Does anyone have any authority or right or control over where he is born? No, you don't have a control. You don't send a text message to your parents and say to them, you know, before you're born, please let me born in Hawaii. I like Hawaii, you know. Also, I get a U.S. citizen so I could become the president one day, inshallah, you know. Better than the one who's going to become the next president. God knows what will happen next. So, I want... No, you have no control over that. These are all matter of creations, takween. Takween, there's no choices here to be made. Allah dictates. That's called wilaya takweeniyya. Allah dictates. Allah creates, and that's how things are. In those matters, no choices are made by people. Okay. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ خلص. When Allah dictates something, with the creation aspect, when He says happen, of course He does not say physically, you know, when He wants it to happen, it happens. Done. That's one. Second one is legislation. Allah has the power of legislation. Allah tells us, Muslims, I want you to pray 5 times a day. I want you to fast the month of Ramadan. I want you to pay khums. I want you to wear hijab, etc., etc. That's what Allah, that's legislation. Tashri', legislation. There, you have a choice. Allah does not force you to pray 5 times a day. Allah does not force you to fast the month of Ramadan. That's where you have a choice. Allah would like you to follow, but does not force you to follow. All right, you see the difference? Creation aspect, no choice. Legislation, yes. You have a free will, and that's where the free will comes in. Inna hadaynahu sabil, imma shakiran wa imma kafura. We've shown him the path. He either follows or doesn't follow. He's either grateful or ungrateful. And that's why on the day of judgment, he'll hold us accountable. I did not interfere with your decision. You made the decision. Now you'll be held accountable for it. That's where some of the other Muslims got into that trap. They did not distinguish between those two differences. Wilaya takwiniyya and wilaya tashri'iyya, the creation and legislation. They mix things up because they did not follow Ahlul Bayti alayhim as-salam. So they use their own understanding, their own reasoning. They turn to the Quran. Some of the verses in the Quran say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَدَ شَيْئًا يَقُولَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Whatever Allah dictates, Allah will make it. We have no choice. So we don't have a free will based on these ayat and similar ayat to these ones. Others, Muslims said, and those were the Asha'irites, Al-Asha'ira. The Mu'tazilites came and said, no, what nonsense is this? We have complete free will. Allah says, we've shown him the path. He either is grateful or ungrateful. They mix things up. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam came to clarify the situation. He says, both of you guys did not understand. It's not a complete free will, nor is it complete predestiny. It's a mix between the two. Matters of creation, yes, that's predetermined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot change how the sun rises, how the sun sets, day, night, things like this, you know, who's born, who's not born, where he's born. These matters, you don't play with these things. But when it comes to legislation, following the laws, that's, yes, you can, that's up to you. That's where you have a free will. Here, since we touched on this topic, I just want to clarify an important point, because some people, they question this. They say, okay, so you're saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us.
Yes.
You're saying that with matters of creation, we have no choice. So yes. With matters of legislation, tashri', I have a choice. All right? So if I follow what Allah said to me, then I will end up in Jannah, inshallah. Correct? We say yes, inshallah. If you follow the guidelines, generally speaking, you'll end up in Jannah. And if I don't follow the guidelines, then I will not end up in Jannah. We say yes. Generally speaking, these are the guidelines. Ahsan rahmallahu alaykum. May Allah give you tissue in Jannah, inshallah. You know. So, is that true? Say yes. So then the question will, some people ask, well, does Allah know that I'm going to go to Jannah or not? Does he know? We say, yes, he does. So then how is it, you know, how is that fair? He knows already whether I'm going to go to Jannah or Jahannam. Where's the fairness there? We say, yes, his knowledge, and please pay attention to this. This is very important. His prior knowledge did not or does not interfere with your decision making. What do I mean by this? Please listen to me. especially those of you who have younger siblings, or you have young children, or have had young children, you'll understand what I'm going to say. I'm going to give you an example. If you have children, 2-year-old approximately. Sometimes your son or daughter, 2-year-old, they're still innocent. You know, if you've seen those 2-year-olds, they're still very innocent. They still don't know how to lie. You know, and when they lie, you can tell. You know, the father or the mother can immediately read their eyes and know exactly what they're thinking and what they're doing. You know, they're still innocent. So suppose you have a 2-year-old son, for example. He takes the keys, your keys, and starts hitting them on the table. Do, 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 do. You know, it drives you crazy. You, as a parent, run to this child and say, give me the keys. You take the keys away from you. This child starts crying and tells you, you know, he just started to learn how to talk. He's thinking, please give it back. Please, please, give back, give back. You know, say, well, if I give it back to you, you're going to do this again. The child looks at you and says, no, no. Now, you as a father or as a mother, you can read their eyes because they're innocent. They don't know how to lie very well. You can read their eyes that they're lying. That the minute you can give them these keys, he's going to take it again, do the same thing over again. You can read their eyes. Maybe those of you who have children, maybe they attest to this. Something along these lines. Something similar to this incident. The parents had the prior knowledge. As a parent, I knew. Because I looked at my son. I know my son very well. And I know he's going to do it again. That's my prior knowledge. However, I test him. What do? I give him the keys and I say, here, take these keys. Let me test you now. And what does he do? Huh? Do, 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 do again. Now, question. Please pay attention. Did my prior knowledge in any way interfere with his decision? Huh? Did I somehow psychopathically, you know, influence his decision? No. I had the prior knowledge as a father. I knew my son. And I know he's not telling the truth. He's going to do this again. That's my prior knowledge. However, my prior knowledge did not in any way, shape, or form interfere with this child's decision. He had the complete free will to do and choose whatever he wants to do. Therefore, it justifies it for me as a father to discipline him, to consequence him, to punish him by taking those keys away from him a second time and not giving it back to him again. You see this? Similarly, and that's just an analogy here. They say in Arabic, Al-Amthal, Tudrab wa la tuqas. Let me just give an analogy here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's prior knowledge does not in any way, shape, or form interfere with our decision making. He'll make the decisions. And therefore, on the day of judgment, he can hold us what? Accountable. Either rewards us, inshallah, or God forbid, punishes us. Is that clear? Do we understand now? Wilaya takwiniya, the creation. Do we have control over that? No, we don't. Wilaya tashri'iya, legislation. Do we have control over that? Yes, we do. Following it or not to follow it? That we have control over. That's as much. Okay. Does anyone else have that power? Our response, independent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one, nothing, have or has any power to control anything. Independent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the creator. Allah is the one. He has no partner, no associates. Nothing is like him. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. Nothing is like Allah. Nothing competes with Allah. Nothing can be compared to Allah. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. Nothing. Nothing. So independent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can do anything without his permission. Okay? Great. So far so good. I don't think any Muslim argues with this point. Right? Okay. However, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to give some powers to some of his creation, is he capable or not? Does he have that ability? Yes, he does. Allah has the power to give some powers to some of his creations. Great. Has he done it? Say, yes, he does. Where? If we turn to Surah Ali Imran, Prophet Isa alayhi salam. Prophet Isa, in verse number 49, he says, in part of that verse, أَنِّي أَخْلُقُ لَكُم مِّنَ الطِّينِ كَهَيْئَةِ الطَّيْرِ. I create for you from clay the form of a flying object. Okay. whether it was a bird, or some of the Mufassirin say it may have been the bat, that he made the bat. Either way, now, this is not our discussion. Whatever he made, something that can fly. He shaped it, he molded it from the clay. And he's saying, I am creating. أني أخلق لكم. I create for you. I create. من الطين, from the clay, the form of a flying object, a bird. طيب. فأنفخ فيه. I blow in it. فيكون طيرا بإذن الله. I blow. You know, Isa creates. أخلق. I'm a creator. I create in the form of the clay. I blow in it and the bird flies. Isa did not create that mold. And they say, Ya Allah, give it life. No, that's not what the Quran says. Isa created the mold. Then he said, fly, and flew. But with the permission of who? Allah. In other words, Allah gave Isa the ability to create. And that's why, interestingly, if you read the Quran carefully, look at the words of the Quran, it's so beautiful. Allah, when he describes himself as a creator, what does he say? He says, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ. Glorified be Allah, the best of the creators, the best. Which means there are other creators as well. But those creators are not compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are dependent on his power. He does not depend on anyone else. Okay? He's the best of them. His form is the best form, and so on and so forth. Okay, that's one. So does Isa alayhi salam have the ability over the creation aspect of things? Takween? Yes, he does. According to the ayah. Yes, Allah gave him that ability. What else? Only then? No. وَأُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. I cure those diseases that cannot be cured. And I revive the dead. Revive the dead. أُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Isa used to go to a grave and would tell the person in the grave, قُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Rise with the permission of Allah. And that person would rise, would get up. He would not stand on the grave and say, Ya Allah, revive this man. No, get up. He gives the order. But with the permission of Allah. And who can revive the dead? No. Allah revives the dead. Allahul Muhyi and Mumit. He's the one who takes life away and gives life, right? Well, Isa right now is saying, I'm giving life. So what, is this shirk? Huh? Is this shirk? No, why not? Because he's doing it with the permission of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave him that ability. Not only this, my brothers and sisters, let me tell you something else. When the friends and the companions of Prophet Musa alayhi salam in Surah Al-Baqarah, the ayah of Baqarah, the ayah of the cow, the story of the cow. When the Prophet's, you know, companion, Musa's companions came to him, they said, a man has been killed from the children of Israel. We need to find out the murderer. He told them that Allah tells me, go kill a cow, slaughter a cow, take a piece of it and hit it with the mayyit. And that mayyit will rise and he will tell you who killed him. Cow? I mean, shirk? Wal'a'adhu billah. Shirk. What do you mean, cow? This is associating someone with Allah. No, we say, no, it's not, because Allah ordered it. Allah said. That's why they questioned Musa alayhi salam. Are you serious? Are you joking with us? He said, أعوذ بالله أن أكون من الجاهلين. No, I would never do something or say something out of ignorance. والعياذ بالله. Never, no. This is the order of Allah. Allah ordered you to do this. Allah says, go take a cow and hit the cow. What's the symbol of the cow? Who cares about the cow here? Couldn't Allah just, you know, revive that dead person? But Allah is teaching us lessons here. Allah is giving us lessons. Allah orders us this way. As long as Allah orders it this way, خلاص, we follow. By the permission of Allah, we don't have a problem. What else? وَأُنْبِئِكُمْ بِمَا تَأْكُلُونَ وَمَا تَدَّخِرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ. And I also can tell you, I can tell you of what you eat. What? No, go home now. I'll tell each one of you. You have tamanqima. You have bagilla. You have, I don't know, curry. You have this, this, this. And we go home and I tell each one of you, this is what your food is. And you have pizza as well, no problem. There's pizza, burgers, no problem. So, I will tell you, you go home. Tell me, isn't this ilmul ghayb? The knowledge of the unseen? Did Isa go in each person's house and see what they've cooked? Okay. Who told Isa that each person has this, cooked this, this, this? Who told him? Allah told him. Isn't this ilmul ghayb? The knowledge of the unseen. Isa never saw it, but he's still... So can someone have the knowledge of the unseen? And the answer is yes, by the permission of Allah. Allah is, not only will I tell you what you are having for food, I can even tell you what are you saving. Back then they did not have refrigerators, so people used to save some food for the winter. You know, they would save food. I can tell you what food you're saving too. Isn't this ilmul ghayb? Yes, it is. Is this shirk? No, it's not. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Prophet Isa that ability. So Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given an ability in matters of creation to some of His servants and creation? Yes, He does. Some of His creation have the ability over taqween, over this creation. Not only prophets. When Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam wanted the throne of Balqis, the queen of Sheba, in Surah An-Naml, to be given to him, to be brought to him, a jinn said, I can get it to you before the end of the day. A jinn can travel quickly and bring it back. Then a man who had some knowledge of the book, some knowledge, Asif bin Barkhiya, Sulaiman's alayhi salam nephew, his nephew from his sister. Sulaiman had a sister, her son Asif was his successor, was his wasi. And he wanted to prove to people that he is my wasi. He is the one who has the best ability to lead after me. So he used this as a way. When everyone was a witness, the jinn said, I will get it to you before the end of the day. Asif said, I can get it to you before you even blink. And within a matter of a second, it was there. Isn't this an ability over the creation? Yes, it is. Did Asif get it on his own? No, he didn't. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him that ability. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says in a hadith, whatever power or ability or permission Allah has given to any of His prophets, He has also given it to us, Ahlul Bayti alayhim as-salam. Everything they can do, we can do. Allah has given it to us as well. Isa can revive the dead, we can do it as well. Isa can tell the ghaib, the unseen, we can do it as well. He can cure, we can do it as well. And so on and so forth. Any power, any ability Allah has given. Ibrahim has the ability to control the fire, we have that ability as well. That fire did not burn, but we have that ability to order the fire not to burn us. And so on and so forth. That is the matter of taqween. Do they have a power over legislation? Legislation. Okay, so that's matter of taqween. Does Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and Ahlul Bayt have the ability to legislate? And the answer is yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him this permission, this ability. Allah says, Ati'u Allah wa ati'u who? Ar-Rasul. Obey Allah and obey the messenger. One. Second, Allah says in Surah Al-Ahzab, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa ma kana li mu'minin wa la mu'minatin idha qaballahu wa rasuluhu amran an yakuna lahumul khiyaratu min amrihim. No male or female believer, if Allah and His messenger, Allah wa Rasuluh, dictate and give a command, has an ability to object to it. Whatever Rasulullah says, you have to follow. Khalas. So that is the legislation, permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In addition, in Surah An-Nisa, Allah tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, Inna anzalna ilayka al-kitaba bil-haq litahkuma bayna an-nas bima araka Allah. Allah has sent down the book to you with the truth so that you judge, you perform a hukum, litahkuma. You can legislate bayna an-nas, between people, with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught you. Allah has given the knowledge to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Just like Allah gave the knowledge to Isa to tell the people the unseen, Allah has given the power of legislation to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi as well. All right? So as per the ayat of the Quran, they have a power of legislation. Not only them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ati'u allaha wa ati'u rasul wa ulil amri minkum. Verse 59 in Surah An-Nisa. Obey Allah and obey the messenger and those who have a right or a command, wilayah, ulil amr, over you. Who are those? Allah says, Innama waliyukum Allah wa rasuluhu wa alladhina amanu alladhina yuqimuna as-salata wa yu'tuna az-zakata wa hum raki'un. Therefore they are Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Now a person might ask, well, how could Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam have the power to legislate? Legislate. Isn't the religion completed with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? So then what do they legislate? Response. We say, religion is completed. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. But that completion came with what? With the wilayah. The completion came and occurred with the wilayah. When the wilayah was appointed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, now the religion is completed. Therefore, this wilayah has that ability to legislate because the religion is completed with them, through them. So they can legislate. Otherwise, if that wilayah is interrupted, if we say there is no wilayah, khalas, Rasulullah and finish, then the religion is incomplete. It's incomplete. What do I mean by this? Let me give you this example, brothers and sisters, so that hopefully it will clarify. One of the companions of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam was a man by the name of Muhammad ibn Muslim. Muhammad ibn Muslim. Muhammad ibn Muslim says, one night I was sleeping at home. It was a hot night, so I was sleeping on the roof of my house. In the middle of the night, I hear a bang on my door. Doof, doof, doof. Ajib. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. In the middle of the night, he comes down, opens the door, he finds an old lady. She tells him, are you Muhammad ibn Muslim? He says, yes. I have a question. Yes. I have a daughter. She's 9 months pregnant. She is now in labor. She was in labor. She's about to deliver a baby. However, she died. She died in labor. This used to happen in the past. So I can see the baby is alive inside her. The baby is moving. But now what do we do? What do I do here? This is a problem. Because she just died. The Prophet says you cannot mutilate the body of a dead person. And this is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. So whatever those Muslims or so-called Muslims are doing in the name of Islam, where they mutilate the body of dead people, this is contradictory to all the teachings of the Quran and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. That is the action of the kuffar, not the Muslimin. The kuffar in Uhud, they did this to Muslims. They did this to Hamza salamullahi alayhi, mutilated his body after his. That's the kuffar, not the Muslims. Muslims never would go mutilate the body of anyone or anything. Even the animals, the hadith says, don't even mutilate the animals after they're dead. So from that retrospect, we don't want to mutilate her body, you know. But at the same time, the baby is alive. So what do I do? Here's a dilemma. Muhammad ibn Muslim says, I heard my master, Imam al-Baqir salamullahi alayhi, saying when such a scenario arises, then it is permissible to cut the lady, to cut basically the part where they need to cut, so that they can take the child out. If the child is still alive, you take him out. She said, okay, jazakallah khair, great. Now I'll go back and I'll tell them what to do. But then Muhammad ibn Muslim said, just a second. Yes. Who told you about me? Who gave you my address? Listen to this. She said, I went to Imam Abu Hanifa. I asked him that question. And he did not know the answer. So he told me, go to Muhammad ibn Muslim. He will have the answer. When you hear his answer, come and tell me. Come and tell me. Muhammad ibn Muslim, just to finish the story, he says, the next day, I was walking by the class of Abu Hanifa. I saw him teaching this mas'ala to his students. Who gave the legislation in this case? From Imam who? Al-Baqir salamullahi alayhi. Without that hadith from Imam al-Baqir, this man, Abu Hanifa, could not understand what to do. There's no answer. So who legislated? Imam al-Baqir salamullahi alayhi. Because the hadith of Imam al-Sadiq, which applies to all the imams, whatever we say comes from our fathers, which comes from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Jibra'il. And that's why the poet says, "Uwali unasan qawluhum wa hadithuhum rawa jadduna an Jibra'il an al-Bari." Says, I follow people as my masters who all their sayings comes from their grandfather, from Jibra'il, from Allah. Imam al-Sadiq, in other words, says, whatever legislation I give you, it's not just what I feel or what I think is right or wrong. No, this is from Allah. These are the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So yes, they do have the power to legislate, and that's why Allah says, obey them, ulil amr. You have to obey them. Obey them. What does this obedience entail? And here, I'll spend a few minutes. So far, brothers and sisters, we have come to the conclusion, so far, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a mastery over creation, wilaya takwiniya, and wilaya tashri'iya, over legislation. Allah dictates to us how many prayers we need to pray, how do we fast, etc., etc. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his permission, may transfer that power, not transfer, sorry, give that power, give, doesn't transfer, give that power to some of his creations, including the prophets, the imams, and even people who are not prophets, like that jinn or Asaf bin Barkhiyah. Okay? Allah gives that power. Our holy prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, as well as the imams, alayhimus salam, have that power over creation and legislation. And there are numerous examples where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi cured someone who was suffering from an illness, or the Imams alayhi salam have done that, or the Imams have turned sand into gold. Numerous such examples. Bit tawatur, even from non-Shia books. Anyone who's interested, you can refer one reference. I can give you many, but one is Kitab Nur al-Absar al-Shablanji. He gives you some of these references, of these miracles that the Imams perform by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Given that, what is then our relationship with them? What should we do? If that's their wilaya, what is our responsibility as mu'aleen? Four things. They are combined in the acronym ROPE, R-O-P-E. The reason I chose this acronym, because Allah says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and hold on tightly to the rope of Allah and do not disunite. And they are the rope of Allah, as per the hadith. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam says, we are Hablullah, we are the rope of Allah. So this rope, what do we need? The R is for recognition, to recognize who they are, to recognize them. It's important to know who they are, to recognize them, to realize their greatness, their abilities. If you work in a big company, but you don't recognize the head of the company, one day he might come next to you and he tells you, listen, I want you to do this for me. So what? What? Go. I'm busy. Go do it yourself. Until, you know, your friend tells you, whoa, 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 you know, do you know who this guy is? No, who is he? He's the boss. This is the big guy. Big guy. Oh, I'm sorry, I apologize, I did not know who you are. Right? That'll be your reaction. Why? Why did you do this? Because you didn't recognize him. If you recognize him, you would not have behaved that way. If we recognize Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, their greatness, their status before Allah, then we'd give them the respect they deserve. That's one. R. Recognition alone is good? No, it's not good. Because this boss, now that I've recognized him, he tells me, listen, I want you to do all this work. You know, he gives me a list. I look at this list, I look at him, I say, okay, boss, yes. The minute he leaves, I say, Ya Allah, kill him, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, destroy him, Ya Allah. You know, look at all this. What a terrible boss he is. You know. So that's not good enough. I have to obey him. I have to obey that boss. Okay. And that is the O for obedience. Obedience. If you don't obey the boss, what's gonna happen? Huh? He'll tell you, ma'a salama, go. Find somewhere else. There has to be the obedience part. And that is the O. R, recognition. O for obedience. Obedience alone is enough? No. Because I can obey him, but I hate him. I hate this boss. You know. So there has to be the P. And that is the profession of love. You gotta profess your love. That I recognize them. I obey them, but I obey them wholeheartedly, with love. I don't ask you for anything but al-mawaddata fil qurba. Mawadda, love, which stems from recognition and obedience. And then, is that enough? I love them, I recognize them, I obey them. No, you got to show the actions, and that's where the E comes in, and that's the enactment. You got to act like a mu'min, like a follower. If the Imam, salamullahi alayhi, says to me, I want you, today we're just having a whole seminar about taqleed. If the Imam says, I want you to do taqleed, and I gave the hadith, I'm not going to repeat them again, then I have to say, khalas, you know, so I got to do it. If the Imam, salamullah alayhi, tells me to wear the hijab, okay. Imam tells me that you can't wear gold, okay. You can't backbite, okay. Khalas, and so on and so forth. That's the enactment. I got to obey them, love them, respect them. So the R for recognition, to recognize them, ma'rifah. The O for obedience, ta'a. The P for love, mawadda. And E for enactment, amal, action. Okay. When you do this, then inshallah, you're an individual who qualifies as a follower. Now, to what degree is a person a follower? We'll get into that tomorrow, inshallah. Some people have high rate of submission. Some have very low. Tomorrow, when we talk about the manners of the Shia, the manners of the followers, we'll touch light on this, inshallah, shed some light on this matter. But I can give you an example of Ummul Baneen, salamullahi alayha. This lady was not ma'sumah. She was not infallible. Okay? She was just like you and I. But this lady recognized the Imams, recognized Ahlul Bayt. She obeyed them. She loved them. And she acted upon it. If I measure myself against Ummul Baneen, where do I stand? Can I say that Ummul Baneen is a Shia and I'm a Shia? You know, I backbite, I cheat, I lie, I don't wear the hijab, or I don't wear the hijab the way the imams want me to. I sometimes, to earn my living, might do certain things which the imam may not be happy with, cut corners. I disrespect some of my, and then I call myself Shia. Let me take a look at this lady. She recognized how great Ahlul Bayt were. And so she told her children, sons, you are my sons. But Hassan, Hussein, Zainab, Umm Kulthum, alayhim as-salam, they are the sons of who? And the daughters of Fatima, children of Fatima, to Zahra, alayhi as-salam. There is no comparison between this Fatima and that Fatima. That's what she used to teach her own children. Ummul Baneen's name was Fatima, but she says, yes, my name is Fatima, but there is no comparison between this Fatima and that Fatima. And that's what she used to teach her children. She recognizes who is Fatima to Zahra, alayhi as-salam. Who is she? She recognized that. She obeyed Ahlul Bayt. She professed their love. And she acted. She ordered her sons to take care of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, Zainab al-Kubra salamullahi alayha. And they left Medina. This lady then acted upon it. You know, interestingly, when the battle of Jamal took place, the battle of Jamal, Umm Salama wrote to Imam Ali salamullahi alayhi a letter. She said, Allah has ordered us, the wives of the Prophet, to stay at in-house, to stay at our homes, not to go out. If that were not the case, I would have come to fight with you personally, on your side, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Umm Salama, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi, a great lady, a noble lady. She told him, if Allah did not order us, the wives, to stay, I would have come myself to fight with you, to support you. But I cannot do that. However, what I will do, I will send my son to fight with you. That's my show of support. That's my show of obedience, of your love. She sent one son. Ummul Baneen sent four sons. Not just one, four. With Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi, to show her love, to show her support, her loyalty. And all her concern was, when will Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam come back? That is what matters, not my sons. I don't care about them. I care about Imam al-Husayn, his safety, his protection. She sent them, the caravan left Medina. This lady sat down. She did not hear back the news. She's waiting now. She's waiting patiently to see them back again. Until one day, when Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam reaches on the outskirts of Medina with the caravan of Imam al-Husayn. But this caravan has no more men left with it other than himself. He finds a man by the name of Bishr ibn Hazlam. He says, Bishr, your father was a poet. Can you also recite verses of poetry, compose them? He said, yes, Ibn Rasulullah, I can. He said, then go to Medina and inform them of the news of the death of my father, Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. Spread the news to Medina before we come in, so that the people of Medina start getting in the state of mourning as we get in. Ahlul Bayt love the mourning of Imam al-Husayn. Love your tears, my brothers and sisters. Imam al-Sadiq loves these tears. And in fact, Imam al-Sadiq prays to Allah and he says, Oh Allah, have mercy, rahmah, on those people who shed these tears. So all of you, inshallah, are included in the rahmah of Imam al-Sadiq, salamullah, in the dua of Imam al-Sadiq. Rahmatullah. Bishr ibn Hadlam says, I headed back to Medina running. I went over the streets of Medina, one after the other, calling them, O people of Medina, O people of Yathrib, which was the original name of Medina, people of Yathrib, get out of your homes, leave the city of Medina. Everyone came out of their house telling me, Bishr, what is the matter? He told them, I will tell you the news at the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Everyone gathered there. He says not a single person remained in their house. The whole city of Medina gathered at the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And then I delivered the news, Ya Ahla Yathrib la muqam lakum bi'ayya qutil al-Husayn fa'admu'i midrar الجسم منه بكربلاء مضرج والرأس منه على القنايات يدار Oh people of Medina, Hussein has been killed in Karbala. His body is on the plains of Karbala, while his head on the spears touring from one city to another city. Everyone in Medina started weeping and crying, Aywa Hussein! Aywa Sayyida! At that moment, he says, an older lady came from the crowd, making her way through them. She approached me and said, Ya Bish, I heard you have news about my son, Abi Abdullah. I asked about her. They told me, Ya Bishr, this is Ummul Banin al-Arba'a. This is the mother of Abbas. Be careful how you deliver the news to her. When she asked me, I did not know how to reply, what to say to her. So I started telling her, Ya Umm al-Bani, your youngest son was killed in Karbala. She told me, Ya Bishr, I'm not asking you about my youngest son. Tell me about my son, Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. She refers to him as my son. I want him back. I don't want the four back. Tell me about him. Is he back? So then I told her, your second son, your third son. Until I told her, Ya Umm al-Bani, عظم الله لك الأجر بمصاب أبي الفضل العباس. Even Abbas was killed in Karbala, Ya Umm al-Bani. At that moment she cried. I saw her tears. And she said, Ya Bishr, لقد مزقتني آت قلبي أخبرني عن ولدي الحسين كلهم فداء للحسين عليه السلام. May all of them be sacrificed for Hussein, even Abbas. I love him, but may even he be sacrificed. Just tell me, is Hussein back? Then I told her, and we're telling you, Ya Shia, عظم الله لكم الأجر بمصاب أبي عبد الله الحسين رحم الله المنادي أيوا حسين
أيوة إمامة أيوة شهيد أيوة سيدة شكراي صرخت هايا وكأني بها تنادي أنا لقعد على درب الضعون وأناشد ليرحون ويجون كل من لها غياب يلفون وأنا غايب باللحد مدفون ولا جو ولا جو ولا جو أربع أولاد اللي راحوا أربع أولاد اللي راحوا ولا جو أنا بعد أرض ما تلمني ولا جو على الغبر أشكثر لاعو ولا جاو ارفعوا راسي بجهاد الغاضرية ارفعوا راسي بجهاد Zainab came back to the grave of Rasulullah crying, Ya Jadda, Ya Rasulullah, جئتك ناعية ولدك الحسين قتل شهيدا في كربلاء. Oh my grandfather, Ya Rasulullah, I'm bringing you the news of your beloved Hussein. The body of Hussein, the chest of Hussein that you used to keep on your chest lies under the horses of Bani Umayyah. The neck of Hussein that you used to kiss is on the spears of Bani Umayyah. أخوك حسين وين وين عبايا شقول حسين ظل جثة بلا راس وعباس النفل قطعة ويمين هذه نساؤك من يكون إذا سرت إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين.
اومدن از مدینه بیان بیرون، کاروان داره از مدینه خارج میشه. ام البنین واسطه آقازاده‌هاش کنار هم دیگه میخوان از شهر خارج شن. قمر منیر بنی هاشم نزدیک شد با مادر خداحافظی کنه، دید هی مادر عقب میره. مادر دارم میرم سفر، چرا فقط میری؟ هم خداحافظی کنم باید. مادر ببین چه میکنه با آدم. گفت مگه نمیبینی زینب داره نگاه میکنه؟ حواست نیست این بچه ها مادر ندارن؟ مادر چقدر مهمه. بعد چی میگه مادر داری مسافرت میری؟ چی میگه؟ برو زود برگردی ها. عجیبه، الله اکبر، چی میگه به برفز؟ پسرم برو دیگه بر نگرد، اگه حسین اومد بیا. دل این غافل قرص است، عمو تا زنده است. گوشواره نخورد دست، عمو تا زنده است. نمیدونم، شاید کسی گره به کارش اسم باب الحوائج برده شد. رفت تا آرزوی آب برآورده شود، حاجت دختر ارباب برآورده شود. رفت در مشت بریزد همه دریا را، تا کسی عشق نریزد همه دریا را، رفت تا خیمه پر از لاله پرپر نشود و روابین همه شرمنده اثر نشود. مثل شیر از وسط لشکر دشمن رد شد، دل به دریا زدنش باعث جزر و مد شد. خیلی از لشکریان با رجزش جان دادند، از همان تیر نگاهش به زمین افتادند. عکسی از ما که در آینه آب افتاد، تا دستش زد که آب یاد لبهای ترک کرده ارباب افتاد. من به رفقا عرض کردم این یه استراتژی که جنگیه، ابوالفضل که میخواد آب بنوشه، یعنی آی دشمن عباس به آب رسید. اما ساقیه
شده سوار اسمش، راهی خیمه های شاهه. بذار ببینم از تو خیمه چشم همه حرم براه.
یه چورایی دلم شون
آب خنک شبیه بارون، مهمون میاره برا مهمون. به خواب تا انتظار کم شد، تا وقتی که بیادم میشون
به خواب عزیزم.
امو با مشک خالی رفته، کار امو نشد نداره. عباسه گریبون نهر رو میتونه
بگیره تا حرم بیا.
وای اگه آب نخورده باشه، جون به تنش نمونده باشه. وای اگه رو زمین بیفته،
از رو زمین نتونه باشه.
یه سر صدا داره مشکوک میشه، صدای هل هل میاد از سمت نه، کنار حلقم شلوغه.
نه قاسمی نه اکبری نه اونی نه جعفری، بابا تنها
کنار حلقم شلوغه. حسین تنها بین لشگر، رو دامنش گرفت در با
سر شکسته برادر.
مادر شهید دیدی برای بچه‌ش چجوری گریه میکنه؟
از تموم حاصلم یه مشک پاره دیدم نور به قبرت بباره چه کردی رو سپیدم آب رو دادی به آب با این کاری که کردی زنده کردی قصه وفا و عشق و مردی بذارم تا
امید امم بنی شدی مقتوع الیمین بخر ما روز جزا شهیدان در یا عباس حسرت آن مقام تو روز جزا شهیدان در حسرت آن مقام تو گفته به تو به نفسی انت امام تو مدد عزیز ام البنین عزیز ام عزیز ام البنی
عزیز ام البنی
آبرویم خورده تیر کجا برگردم کجا برگردم کجا برگردم دست خالی از میدان چرا برگردم چرا برگرد برگرد که این قافله را بیم آتش نیست ما تشنه لب عشق تو هستیم علم دار عمو برگرد آبرویم خورده تیر کجا برگردم کجا برگردم دست خالی از میدان چرا برگردم خدایا بی طاقتم پر از شرم و خجلتم شده زخمی غیرتم به هل هل شدم آگه هل هل می کردن کنار عباس عباس یه چیزی رو اونجا دستش اومد متوجه شد به هل هل شدم آگه ز بی حیایی لشگر به زن گره دگر بر مجرد خواهر خواهر من یک به یک به اهل حرم گفت وای ابوالفضل رفت معجر من رفت وای وای خواهر من یک به یک به اهل حرم گفت وای ابوالفضل رفت معجر من رفت مدد عزیز ام البنین مدد کن ما رو مدد حالا برادرش داره میگه حالا امام حسین میگه بند آخره پاره پاره شد مشکت فدای اشکت فدای اشکت فدای اشکت می کشم تیر از چشمت فدای اشکت خون گریه میکنی عزیزم برادرم قد من را کرده خم، دوتا بازوی قلم، تن پاشیده زهم. اول فاز عزیز برادر، شکستنت کمرم را شکست و جار زدند، قدم قدم خبر انکسار من پیچید، همه فهمیدن. آه قد من را کرده خم، الان انکسر دهری، دوتا بازوی قلم، تن پاشیده زم، شده قیامتی برپا، سرت به دامن زر. شده قیامتی برپا، سرت به دامن زر، دوباره تازه شد داغ سر مولا، دوباره داغ امیرالمومنین تازه شد. مادرم اومده، عباس ام البنین نیامده، زهرا که آمده بی دست من، به خاطر زهرا بلند شد. ام البنین نیامده، زهرا که آمده بی دست من، به خاطر زهرا بلند شد. حسین قتیل الاریان، حسین قتیل الاریان، حسین
Oh,
دیدم چشم نازت را دریدم، چو تفلانی سخنها را شنیدن، همه از هم خجالت می کشیدن، همه از هم خجالت می کشیدن. انیس گریه هایم را توان دست و پایم را گرفتم، کمانی تر شدم از زینب افسوس، سر پیری عصایم را گرفتم، سر پیری عصایم را. مسلمانان حسین مادر ندارم، غریب است و کسی بر سر ندارم، ز جور ساروان بیمار دیگر انگشت و انگشت ندارم، دیگر انگشت و انگشت گل احساس را از من میگیرم، گل احساس را از من مگیری، شمیم یاس را از من نگیری، همه دارم ندارم را بگیری، فقط عباس را از من نگیری.
به یاد همه قدیمی ها، من اینو خوندم که همه بخونید. تموم زندگی مال حسین،
دلم هم با
جانم
کجایی ده شهیدانه،
به یاد همه شهدا، شهدای اخیر،
خدایی بلا جویان
امیر المؤمنین را یار یا ام البنین ای سراپا پاکی و ایثار یا ام البنین مکتب تو مهربانی اسوه تو فاطمه داری از او همچنان آثار یا ام البنین دامنت عباس پروردامنت عباس پروردامنت عباس پرور همسرت مولا علی مرتضا خوب فاطمه رفتار یا ام البنین بهر فرزندان زهرا بعد زهرا مادری از تو آید ای علی را یار یا ام البنین از تو برد عباس میراث وفا و عشق را تا که شد سقا و پرچمدار یا ام البنین چار فرزند تو در صحرای سرخ کربلا چار شیر بیشه پیکار یا ام البنین چار فرزند شهیدت گشت تقدیم حسین در زمین کربلا هر چار یا ام البنین چار فرزند شهیدت گشت تقدیم حسین در زمین کربلا هر چار یا ام البنین
شنا دارد میآید دیدم که بر دردم دوا دارد میآید آقا آجرک الله عزاداریات قبول از امشب که آبو میبندن تو چه حالی داری دیدم که با شال عذاب و چشم گریان مولای من صاحب عذاب دارد میاد آقا مولا تو بانی این روزه ای تو بانی این روزه ای دریاب ما را آغوش خود بکشا گدا دارد میاد آقا قربون دل داغ دارت برم یه عنایتی به ما بکن آقا نمیبینی مگر در غیبت تو خیلی سر شیعه بلا دارد میاد امشب نمیدانم چه سری هست کینجا بوی شهیدان خدا دارد میان شهادت شهادت همه آرزومه رویای ناتمومه آقا امشب نمیدانم چه سری هست کینجا بوی شهیدان خدا دارد میای در این دهه خط مقدم هیئت ماست از جبهه بوی کربلا دارد می آید اینجا صدای گریه و عطر مناجات از سنگر رزمنده ها دارد می آید دو سه تا سوالم دارم آقا آقا سوالی داشتم آقا سوالی داشتم خیلی وقت این سوال دارم آقا سوالی داشتم از سمت گودا آبای وا اما چرا دارد میای آقا آقا بگو جدت مراقب باشد آخر یک خنجر تیز از قفا دارد میآید آقا آتش به جان خیمه ها افتاد از در پایان تلخ ماجرا دارد میآید دهه اول داره تموش داریم به روز عاشورا میرسیم همراه با آن قافله با دست بسته یک بیبی چادر سیاه دارد میآید پشت سرش یک دختر ناز سه ساله با ناله با غربتا دارد میآید میگوید امه یک نظر بر نیزه ها کن بابای من همراه ما دارد میآید ای حسین
يكن بالدعاء مجلس أم البنين باب من أبواب الحوائج مولى جليلة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها اكشف عنا السوء يا الله اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا كفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار مع محمد وآله الأطهار إلهي بباب الحوائج أم البنين سلام الله عليها نسألك وندعوك أن تمن علينا وعلى ذريتنا إلى يوم الدين، وتجعلنا يا من شيعة الإمام الحسين عليه السلام المتقين يا الله، ومن خدمته المخلصين يا الله، وأن ترزقنا شفاعته في الدنيا وفي القبر وفي الآخرة، وأن تحشرنا في زمرة محمد وآل محمد، وتجعلنا في درجتهم في الجنة يا الله. اللهم بباب الحوائج أم البنين اقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات، شافي وعافي جميع مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات، على الخصوص من أوصونا بالدعاء منهم، اقض حوائجهم، شافي مرضاهم، احفظهم في أنفسهم وفي أهليهم وفي أولادهم وديارهم بحفظك ورحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب، رب ارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا، اجزهما بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات غفرانا. رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج، واكشف هذه الغم عن هذه الأمة بحضوره، واجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة، وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا، حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، لقضاء الحوائج، لشفاء المرضى، ولكشف هذه الغم عن هذه الأمة، ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان. وإلى أرواح أمواتنا وأموات الجالسين والحاضرين والمؤسسين والباذلين على هذا المشروع، وإلى أرواح جميع الشهداء والعلماء وكل المؤمنين والمؤمنات، رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.